Okay, so you decided you wanted to get a leopard gecko. How do you pick a good one? Well, you're gonna go down to your local pet store or possibly to a local reptile expo or reptile show. You're gonna look around and you wanna look for a leopard gecko that is attractive to you and pretty. You also wanna look for one that has bright and gunk-free eyes. You don't want him to have any goop in his eyes or to have his eyes closed or look misshapen or weird. Also check his mouth. Make sure his mouth is clean and clear. No discoloration. It's not hanging limply open at all or any things like that. You know, make sure his toes are all intact. When they're babies like this, they do have a tendency to lose their little toes sometimes to shedding. You want to make sure that their tails are intact. Leopard geckos do have droppable tails, which means they'll let go of them if they're pulled on for defensive purposes. Make sure it's intact and clean and looks good. And then, of course, also check his vent. Make sure it's clear of any goop or garbage. And make sure it's not discolored or swollen in any way, shape, or form. And, of course, make sure he's active, attentive, curious. You should move around. He should run from you a little bit. You know, you want to find a leopard gecko that looks like he's healthy. And that's what we're looking for here, is we're looking for all the key signs that may lead you to problems down the road. Okay, so you've bought your leopard gecko, your cute little guy. You've got your setup, your aquarium, your heating, all that figured out. It's all ready to go. How do you not kill your leopard gecko? Probably have a little baby. So the important thing to remember is with your feeding schedule, and you do want to be on a schedule as close as possible, your feeding schedule, you need to be a little bit diligent with keeping your portions small. Remember, his stomach is only about the size of the space between his two eyes and the top of his head. So it's not a big stomach. It fills up fast. 1 to 2, maybe 3 crickets at the most this size is all they're going to need on a daily basis. If you like to eat daily, just like you do. So make sure you're doing that, but keep your portions small. If you don't, you can overfeed your leopard gecko and cause problems, paralysis, maybe even death. Also, you have to remember to keep him nice and hydrated. You want to keep a full, clean water bowl in his cage at all times. I know, it's a desert animal, but give him that access to fresh, clean water. You want to change it daily, clean the water dish daily. That way you don't get bacteria growing and things like that could be possibly harmful to your leopard gecko and cause problems for both of you. Now we're going to talk about handling your leopard gecko. Now, when you first get him, he's going to be tiny, and they're going to probably be a little bit flighty. They can be pretty fast when they want to be, but they're not sticky-footed, so you don't have to worry about them climbing glass or anything like that. What you want to do is you want to let him pretty much do most of the handling himself. You're going to give him a little area to walk on. You want to be gentle. You can always direct him to certain areas, be nice and firm. If you have to hold him, get him between like a finger and your thumb and just press down ever so lightly. You don't want to crush him. Be very careful. But that can kind of hold him in place so you can get a better look at him, or if you want to show someone, or for whatever reason. Whatever you do, you do not pull on the tail. The tail is not a handling device. It is not a handle. Okay? This is a defense mechanism for the leopard gecko, and he will drop his tail. If you tug on that too hard, it's going to come right off. Now, it doesn't hurt him, but it will startle you, that's for sure. And it's never going to grow back looking quite the same. Now, right now, it looks like a nice, pretty tail. If he were to drop this and to grow back, it'd be bulbous and light bulb shaped. They just never tend to come back looking the pretty and the nice form again. So make sure we're not grabbing by the tail. That's not a handle for a leopard gecko and not necessary. So stay away from that. Next thing we're going to talk about is the proper sized caging for your leopard gecko. Now, when you buy him, he's probably going to be a little baby. And you're going to be tempted to buy a small setup right from the start. I would recommend not doing that. Go ahead and get the proper size setup when he's going to be an adult. It's going to save you money, and it's going to save you time and trouble in the future. So what we're looking at here is we're going to be looking at like a 15-gallon aquarium. Okay, that's an aquarium that's going to be 24 inches long by 12 inches wide and 12 inches high. What you're looking for is floor space here for a leopard gecko. They don't need the height so much, but they want a lot of floor space to move around and crawl on. Remember, your gecko is going to get 5 to 6 inches long, if not maybe a little bit longer. So you want to make sure he has a lot of room to move around. The other thing you need to be taking into account is your screen top. Make sure you have a screen top for your aquarium. And especially make sure that it's one made out of a nice, hard wire. Okay, make sure it's metal, not plastic, cloth, because you are going to be putting heating elements on here and you don't want to melt through it. I generally do recommend as well getting cage clips for the top of the aquarium. Leopard gecko's not going to get out. However, you want undesirables from getting in there. Like, say, if you have a cat or a dog or a younger brother or sister with little hands, they tend to get in the things. So cage clips aren't a bad idea as well. Again, we're looking for floor space here. Bigger is always better. If you want to go even larger, say like a 20 long or something like that, that's fine. Remember, the more space you have, the more leopard geckos you can keep. And they are a fun species to breed. Next thing we're going to talk about today is the substrate that your leopard gecko is going to go on. What substrate? Well, we reptile people like to call the bedding in the aquarium substrate. Sounds a little bit more fancy and high tech. What we're just talking about here, though, is bedding. Okay. Now, it's a couple different beddings that I recommend. I recommend, like, say, a Douglas fir bark or a large wood chip bark. Okay, something big enough a leopard gecko can't eat it. Or I'm going to recommend the cocoa fiber, which is basically a shredded coconut husk, okay? Comes in a brick, usually. Runs around $3 to $4, very inexpensive. This is going to expand out more than enough to do your 15-gallon tank. You soak it in warm water, let it sit for a half an hour. Now, a lot of people are going to want to use sand for the leopard gecko. I don't recommend sand. I don't recommend sand for any kind of lizard because it could cause what's called impassion. Most sands that you're buying on the market, even the calcium sands, are going to be man-made items that when you put them under a microscope are square rather than being spherical like natural sand is. What happens is the animal ingests this slowly over time and it starts to build up in the stomach. It's kind of like playing Tetris inside your reptile. Eventually it causes what's called impaction. They can't properly use the bathroom and they eventually die. So now this sort of thing, sometimes people will tell you, oh, I've never had a problem, I've kept my leopard gecko on sand forever. Well, it's always a risk. And for me, my pet, something that I love, I don't want to take that risk. So I'd much prefer not to use sand, and I'd much prefer that most people out there didn't as well. Next thing I want to talk about is the lighting for your leopard gecko. Not heating, we're not there yet. We're talking about lighting right now. When we talk about lighting, we're talking about UVB light. There's two different ways of getting UVB light. You can get it from compact fluorescent bulbs like this one, or you can get it from your standard fluorescent bulb, the long tubes. Now, you may make sure you're buying the special right kind. You can't just go down to Meijer's and pick up a compact fluorescent bulb in the grocery department. That's not going to do it for you. You need one that's coated with a special coating for UVB light. Generally, you're going to find that in a pet store or possibly online as well. Quite a few different companies make them. What this does is the UVB light is part of the visual spectrum of light that causes reptiles and other creatures as well to create what's called vitamin D3 in their body. Without UVB light, they don't make vitamin D3 so well. What vitamin D3 does is it moves calcium into the bone structure. And without these things, you can get problems like metabolic bone disease, also called rubber jaw or spongy bone, things like that. They're going to cause bone problems. We don't want that, especially in a baby leopard gecko that's growing. It's doing a lot of calcium moving around in his body. You want to make sure he gets to the right place at the right time. So, you want to get yourself a UVB light. Now, this light needs to be replaced every 6 months, whether or not it's burnt out, because the coating on them wears off. So, be aware of that. You can stretch it a little bit longer, but you pretty much want to be on that 6 month dot. After that, your lighting definitely starts to suffer. Next thing we're going to talk about is heating your leopard gecko. Now, in order to heat your leopard gecko properly, you're probably going to end up using heat bulbs for the most part. When we're talking about heat bulbs, there's two different kinds we can talk about. There's your day bulbs and there's your night bulbs. Now, night bulbs can come in red, blue, black, any color like that. It doesn't matter as long as it's dark. It removes the light from the visible spectrum of the reptile. The day bulb is, of course, for daylight use. It's going to illuminate the tank just like you would with a regular light bulb. However, it's going to provide a higher heat. Now, when you're heating your reptile, you want to make sure you buy a heating fixture with a ceramic top on it. Okay, must be ceramic, not plastic. Plastic melts. Also, make sure it's rated for the right wattage that you're going to use. On the packaging, you'll see that they give a rating. This is rated for 75 watts. Okay, for a leopard gecko, you're probably going to want one rated 75 watts and one rated for anywhere up to 150 watts in order to get the proper temperatures. You are going to need two heating fixtures and two light bulbs, a day bulb and a night bulb. The day bulb is going to stay on 24/7. It's going to stay on one side of the aquarium. You're going to leave that on all the time, looking like a 75 watt infrared heat bulb. On the other side of the aquarium, you're going to have your day bulb, okay? That's going to be on for the same time as daylight hours, 8 to 10 hours a day. And turn that off at night, okay? The other thing that we're going to talk about as far as heating goes is your heat pad. Okay. This is a device. It's got a self-adhesive backing on it. You tear it off, and you stick it on the bottom of the aquarium. Make sure you follow the instructions carefully with those. You can crack the bottom of your aquarium if you don't use them properly, if you don't use the rubber feet with them, or if you don't properly attach it. And make sure once you put one of these guys on, you don't take it off because it becomes a fire hazard afterwards by breaking the heating elements inside. This is going to go on the same side as your night bulb. By my side, but then I spent so many nights just thinking how you'd done me wrong.